you own a self-driving car, and it happens to be electric, we didn't ever even think about our own body being in on that trip. Now, the single most expensive thing we're taking out of the car, your time, or a paid driver's time. When you take that out, it's really the cost to move an electric car is about a penny and a half a mile. So I ask you, what would you not do for a penny and a half a mile? You don't have to park it. It's going to be your personal servant doing whatever in heck you want. You know, I left my iPhone at home. Please run back and get it. You know, my kid wants an apple that I didn't pack at his lunch. Whatever. It's peak times. I don't care. Go get it. You will be sending it as your runner everywhere. We want to do the easy and cheap thing, and it's going to cost me no money, and it's not even my time. We will be using them all the time for very low value errands. And they might not be low value to us, but for a city, clogging those streets is a really big issue. If I think about our personal infrastructure, what's going on in my brain? There was a man, Daniel Kahneman, who wrote this beautiful book, Thinking Fast and Slow. And his thesis, he's a behavioral economist, is that we want to do the easiest thing every time. Like, every time, I want to do the easiest thing. And the economics comes in second. Christmas time, my husband was telling me that Amazon had 1,000 products in which you could get 2-hour delivery. And if we think about Amazon Prime, you pay one time, and then you get the whole year for free delivery. So I'm watching my husband, who consumes way more than I do, and the packages are coming in. You know, one toothbrush delivered to my house, a screw delivered to my house. He said it was a difficult screw, it was a complicated screw, we needed this particular screw. And you're watching these deliveries come, and so what happens is there's this car driving around and coming to my house one at a time, and because I like things really easy. So now throw into this self-driving cars, where we can have at our beck and call these cars doing whatever we want. If I think about when we layer in self-driving cars into that equation from a retail perspective, whoa, I can put all of my goods into a car and not pay a driver and do home delivery. I'm going to close my shop and I'm going to be warehousing my inventory on the street so I can deliver to you in 10 minutes, 15 minutes. And so just picture that every store is going to be doing that. So the drugstore, there'll be little mini drugstores driving around. There'll be little mini liquor stores, little mini clothing stores, little mini whatever it is, the 1,000 most purchased items at Amazon. City governments right now make a huge amount of money from you paying for parking and from you doing the wrong things and getting parking tickets. Those two are really big sources of revenue. A self-driving car is never going to park. When I talk to people in the suburbs, they don't get that. But in a city, if I'm going to have to pay $2 an hour to park, I'm not even going to do that because it's going to cost me less than that to have it drive back to my house. And these cars won't ever get parking tickets because they're not going to be doing anything wrong. They're programmed to not break the law. When I'm talking to people who run self-driving car companies, I feel like they're sending like darts out of their eyes or being sent at me. Like, ugh, Robin, stop talking about this. This is a brand new industry. You're ruining it. Give us some time to get it together. And I think, you know what? Cities have spent the last 100 years learning what it means to have metal boxes moving on scarce city streets. That equation is not changing. You take out a driver or not, you still have metal boxes trying to fit through our scarce city streets. And that's what we have to deal with.